Hello, YouTube. My name is Zach. Well, the results are in. The poll is closed, and you guys have all voted on Russell Allen as the next subject of my videos. And here he is, the guy in the middle. Obviously, this is his major band, Symphony X, and this is the project that he's been the frontman of for a long time. He's also been in other projects like Adrenaline Mob, but he's mostly known for being the singer of Symphony X. And I guess the fans call him Sir Russell Allen because he used to joust or something like that. But whatever, I'm not going to call him Sir Russell Allen. I'm going to call him Russell Allen. So I've gotten a lot of questions. For example, one of the biggest ones I've had is, how is Russell Allen singing so well this far in his career? You know, how is his voice so strong? How does he do the raspy stuff? And how does he make it work? And he doesn't have a lot of vocal decay. And today, I'm going to address some of these things. I have four major reasons explaining why his voice is still in good shape. Four and a half, but one of them's a quick one that I'm going to address right now. First off, he's only in his mid-40s. He's 45, 46. Typically, the male vocal peak doesn't hit until you're like 32 and it lasts until you're 50. So by all logic, he's still technically in his vocal prime for a typical tenor or baritone. So that's one reason. We don't really know how quickly he's going to fall off yet. The good news is that he's still in relatively good form and he's still singing very well compared to how he's sung from the beginning. So he's seems to be all right. Now, time will tell. We'll know in about 10 years whether or not his voice holds up as well as someone like James LeBrie. We'll know. But we can definitely say with certainty that he hasn't seemed to have the same sort of vocal issues over the course of his career that James did. I don't know a ton about Russell Allen's background. I don't know how much training he's had. From what I've understood, he didn't really have much formal training, if any at all. I'm sure you guys that are huge fans of his can probably tell me in the comments and let me know how much training he has, but I'm under the impression he hasn't had a lot of training. I'm not quite as big of a fan of Symphony X as I have been of Dream Theater. I know the two bands get a lot of comparison, and they're kind of like, which is better, Symphony X, Dream Theater? It's a little fan rivalry type thing. The reason I haven't listened to Symphony X as much as Dream Theater is that I think that after Paradise Lost, their music just sort of I lost interest. I listened to them a lot when I was in high school and when I was starting college. And as I got older, their music, the content, the subject matter of it just didn't appeal to me as much. But then again, The Astonishing is like that with Dream Theater, with me too. That subject matter just didn't appeal to me. So I think that that's kind of where I'm at when it comes to my opinions of the band. I think that they're incredible. I loved The Odyssey. Like, that album was just fantastic. The Divine Wings of Tragedy was incredible. I love that album. So I'm a big fan of their older work, and I just haven't really paid as much attention to the most recent stuff. I also know that Russell Allen is in Adrenaline Mob and whatever, you know. I know that's a really tragic situation, and I'm not sure what's going to happen with that band, but he's sung in that capacity as well. At any rate, so here are the big four reasons that I believe that Russell Allen is still doing pretty well with his voice, given the type of singing that he does and given the extent of his career. The first reason I would say definitely is that he makes smart business decisions. Now, what do I mean by that? When you watch football, if you got NFL fans out there, if you ever see a quarterback slide before he hits the first down marker, or he puts himself down on the ground before he takes a big hit from a linebacker, or like Cam Newton in the Super Bowl, he doesn't jump on the ball when it's fumbled, you'll hear the commentators say something like, oh, well, the quarterback just made a business decision. And what they mean by that is that to preserve the length of their careers and to make sure that they can stay in the game, they make an extra effort to avoid taking major hits or injuries, things of that nature. So they'll give themselves up and not allow themselves to be hurt. Russell Allen, I can give a personal anecdote about him where I've seen him make that very business decision. I've never seen Symphony X live. However, I should have. In 2005, Symphony X went on Gigantour. Gigantour was this big tour that featured, like, I don't know, 10 bands. I know that it had Megadeth, Dream Theater, Life of Agony, Dillinger Escape Plan, I think Nevermore. I can't remember who all else was on it, but I know that Symphony X was on the bill, and it turned out that I found out about 10 minutes before the set started with everybody, or the whole concert started, that Russell Allen was ill. So they chose to cancel the set on that day because he didn't want to sing while he was ill. Those types of decisions are very smart. They're very prudent. Back then, I was 18 years old. I didn't know everything about the voice that I know now, and I was really bummed because I was looking forward to seeing Symphony X, and I was excited. So I didn't understand then, though. I didn't have as much vocal knowledge. I mean, I was a singer, but I hadn't had the amount of study that I have now. And now, in retrospect, I really respect him for making that decision, because there's no telling what kind of illness it was, and there's no telling what kind of damage it would have done if he had sung with that kind of illness. And unlike certain other singers that I've addressed before, like James LaBrie, he opted to take the safe route and take a night off, let his voice recover, and come back when he was ready. That's the type of vocal hygiene decision that you make if you want to have a long and sustainable career. And so I'm certain that him making those kinds of decisions consistently has a lot to do with his vocal health up to this point. Now, for the next 2 points, I actually managed to find a masterclass that Russell Allen himself did, where he explained some of his approaches to singing. And I'm going to take little snippets of those and use those as examples of why I think his singing philosophy is extremely conducive to his vocal health. One of the things to point out before we get into that, though, is that if you watch videos of him live consistently, you'll see that he doesn't have a lot of facial tension when he sings. He doesn't have a lot of neck tension when he sings. He tends to avoid tension in general, and I think that that has a lot to do with being able to make your voice last a long time as well. Just from a voice teaching perspective, when you tense up your face, you tense up muscles, all this kind of stuff, what it does is it engages muscles that aren't necessary for the mechanism to work. Singing really is just pulling air and vibrating the folds and shaping the way that the sound and the air, the vibration of the air comes out, and that's all that singing is. So when you engage all this extra stuff that doesn't need to be engaged, you cause your body to work harder than it has to. And like anything, if you overexert yourself, then over time you'll pay the price for it. So I would say that his lack of tension in his singing probably has a lot to do with it, but that's not really necessary that anything that he's personally addressed. That's just something that I've noticed upon watching his videos. So this first excerpt I want to pull from the masterclass, where he specifically talks about the way that he approaches singing lines in his songs and the ways that he approaches the process of making sound. Take a look.
When I sing, I talk, but I'm just singing it. So I'm speaking. So when you're trying to say and write music, talk it out. Like, make sure it can be spoken. Correct. And people understand you, like I'm having a conversation with you right now.
So he makes an extremely salient and important point about singing in this little excerpt. You correlate your speaking and your singing to one another. If you take the amount of time you use speaking to the amount of time you use singing, for example, if you just make a proportion or a percentage, there's a really strong chance that 99.99999% of your words are going to be used in speech. And that 0.00001 or whatever percent of your words spoken are sung. So there is a major correlation between the singing voice and the speaking voice. And so it's usually very healthy to make sure that your singing voice lines up very similarly to the way that you speak. One thing that I can always tell when I work with students, one of the biggest indicators that their voices aren't that healthy is when their speaking voice and their singing voice sound drastically different. Your speaking voice is the natural sound that you create, and sometimes we stray away from things like the fundamental frequency or the baseline pitch that our voices comfortably sit at. We'll stray away from that. We'll go too high or too low, something like that. But for the most part, as long as we're within this range of pitches that's close to our fundamental frequency, it's healthy. But when I hear people sing or even speak outside of something that it seems like their voice naturally wants to do, or if they sing and their speaking voice sounds drastically different, those are usually clear indicators to me that they're doing unhealthy things. So by Russell Allen corroborating this point and saying, hey, when I go to sing things, I make sure that my speaking voice and my singing are very closely linked and I sing as if I were speaking it, that is a huge, huge approach that I condone in my lessons. And if you go to any of my voice students, you ask them, they'll tell you, I take that exact approach because it's healthy, it's safe. Your singing voice and your speaking voice are directly linked. Singing in so many ways is simply speaking on a targeted pitch. So if you retain that notion when you sing, it's going to take you a long, 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 long way. The third reason that I believe that Russell Allen has been able to sustain his voice over a period of time in a healthier way is that when he writes his parts, he takes the approach of carrying and conveying the emotional affect of the song and conveying the singing and the music in a way that the audience can completely relate to. And he doesn't try to match the bombast of his fellow bandmates. He says that himself in the same interview, and I think that it's very important to take note of what he says because it's extremely important. When you are playing with a group of instrumentalists, you aren't trying to outplay them necessarily. Take a look to what he has to say.
Because you got to understand, for people who aren't musicians, that they don't quite get what that is. They you lose them. So as a singer, I always felt the responsibility of making sure that I made Symphony X's songs more about the stories we were trying to tell and less about the technical, you know, fireworks that were going off on stage. The different styles or flavors of the voice that I would use in a track like you just heard are all emotionally referenced.
So his intention as a singer is to counterbalance the chaos and the difficult stuff. He wants to create something that can bring the listener back to the center of the music and keep it simple and keep it listenable and enjoyable to the audience members that may grow weary of the crazy time signature changes. This approach and the way he explains this tells me that the thought process of his singing is one of working within the confines of what fits his voice, what fits the music. And he's not trying to match the craziness that the rest of the band is doing. Another thing to point out here that's subtle, but it's really important to point out, is that he writes his own voice parts. And I do plan on making an entirely different video on this subject at some point as well, but he writes his own voice parts, which is crucial to your sustainability as a singer. Lots of times when you perform music that other people write, it's virtually impossible to perform the way they want it because it's not written with the singer's voice in mind necessarily when it's written, much less your specific voice. So when you take that into your own hands and you compose your own parts, you're definitely going to be saving yourself a lot of hassle because you can know that you're never doing anything that's outside of what you're comfortable with or what you know your voice can do. We all have constraints as singers. We don't have 24 frets and 6, 7, 8, 9 strings if you're gent. Of a range to work with at any given point. That's not how the voice works. So we have to work with our own confines. So when you write your own parts and you get to construct them, you can do things that you know that you can sustainably maintain. The final fourth point as to why I think that his voice is healthier and more sustainable is as simple as his touring schedule. Now, I know that Symphony X has gone on world tours and they've toured for albums. They don't release content as frequently as some fans may like, but let's just take a quick look at their touring schedule. Okay, now keep in mind this doesn't take into account bands that he's done like Adrenaline Mob and other shows, but let's just look at his time in Symphony X when he's toured with them. They haven't done a tour in quite a long time, but even then, if you scroll down the list, we'll see that throughout 2011, he had a pretty decent set of shows, and it was pretty nonstop from February until June. And so that was pretty heavy, but if you look, the tour only lasted for half of a year, and then he was done. But before that, they didn't tour really at all heavily until since 2008 before that. 2009, they did a few dates in Asia. But before that, their last big tour was in 2008. So they went a good 3 years without doing any kind of touring whatsoever. And even when they did tours, if you look, the 2008 tours are, let's see, October. So we had February until March, April into May. And then they didn't play again until October, and they just did a brief stint of shows for a few weeks. If you go back to 2007, they extended that same tour, but it was only from... It wasn't the same tour, I'm sorry. It was a different tour, but it was featuring the same album. But it was only from June to August. And you go back, they didn't play at all before that between 2004 and 2008. And then their touring schedule in 2004 was very light. 2003 was a little heavier. I think that's right after the Odyssey came out. But even then, you still have October to December, and that's it. So we don't have data before that on the website. But if you just look at that, from 2003 until 2018, according to the website, Symphony X has probably played less than, definitely less than 200 shows, definitely. And I know they're not as big of a band as Dream Theater, but either way, even when they did tour frequently during a year, it was the number of shows was a lot less. It wasn't year-long tours in four different continents. It was much more laid back in terms of their touring schedule. Touring takes a heavy toll on your voice. If you watch my interview with Robert Edens, you would see, he'd tell you that, you know, it was difficult. I've had lots of talks with him personally to say that tour just ruins your voice. I mean, it's really hard. So he's had a less rigorous singing and touring schedule, and that's a big, big part of why his voice is in better shape. So those are the four reasons that I think are most contributing to his health and sustainability up to this point. And it's just a quick summary. There's a lot more to it than this, but I didn't want to go too in depth with it. I hope that clears some things up for you and explains to you why Russell Allen has such a strong voice at this point. As I said before, we don't know how age is going to treat him. We'll see in 10 years where he's at. And as far as the guttural growly stuff, I don't know how he does it in a way that's sustainable. I think that we still have yet to see the kind of toll he's taking on his voice. I saw a recent video of him from last year where he sung, and he was good. It was good, but he's starting to mark. Marking is where singers take some of the emphasis off of certain elements of the singing to take some of the load off the voice. And he's starting to do some marking more than he used to. So we'll see. I'm not saying that his voice is falling apart. I'm not saying he's a bad singer at all. He's an incredible singer, no doubt. Absolutely. But we just don't know what the future holds. I'd say give it another 5 or 6 years and see where his voice goes from there before we make any final judgments about how sustainable he is. I think he's had a great run up to this point, considering that he's been performing since the late 90s. He's doing a pretty darn good job, and he's maintained his voice pretty well. So I would say that if you wanted to compare him to other singers, the way they treat their voices, he's done a pretty good job, and he's followed some pretty sound, fundamental singing habits with regards to taking care of his voice. So that's it. If you have any questions, please feel free to drop them in the comments. I'd love to hear your thoughts on this. As you all know, I do have a Patreon, and if you subscribe, it would be amazing. It will help me get a better webcam and make this channel better, get some soundproofing, that kind of thing. I'm so thankful of all of your support. I'm so happy to have all of you interested in the subject, and there will be more videos coming in the future. If you haven't yet, like and subscribe to my channel. Every little bit helps. Anything that you can do is helpful. And I will see you all again soon. Take care.